therefore that skews the, what is happening with the students. We have 2.8 million public school students that graduate and yet cannot read and write and do simple math. Our Florida schools, according to NAEP, score in the 50%, and yet our schools are given A's and B's. How can that be? Because this is not, 50% is not an A or a B student. On the 2018 ACT test, Florida ranked 39th. And there are 9 states who were below us, but they tested 100% of their students. Florida only tested 73% of our students. Last February, Bill Gates, who spent over $6 billion, publicly declared Common Core a failure. We do not want to repeat that failure, doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. This is the definition of insanity. The problem is, to me, not so much the standards, it's what are the kids actually reading. I have reviewed textbooks, they are extremely biased, one-sided. That is not the purpose of education. The purpose of education is to provide a skill set so that a child will be able to then make their own decisions. Thank you.
So our final speaker this evening will be Shauna Hadde.
I'm a teacher. I taught for 11 years in the county over, and I'm not currently teaching probably due to the standards and the working conditions, so I felt like I should come and talk. I saw your slide, it turned my stomach a little bit. Considering going back to teaching and also allowing my child to continue on, he's in pre-K now, but I feel like the word rigor has a meaning that's different than what's happening in the classroom. When I think of rigor, I think time to think and problem solve, experiment, and all of that, and there just isn't that time in the classroom because we are all racing to cover the standards in order to take those big tests. I've taught second, third, fourth, and fifth grade. Third grade is probably my favorite for kids' age, but I did not want to teach third grade because of the high stakes testing, so so I hope that you're really addressing that. As a second grade teacher, I think that the kindergarten standards actually stand to be a barrier for success in my classroom, because in kindergarten, those students are expected to do all these things when really they could just focus on sitting, participating, holding a pencil correctly, writing their letters and forming their words with correct spacing, and how to work well with others. When I get them in second grade, their inability to write and hold the pencil correctly actually slows them down. And when I try to do group work, they can't get along with others. We're pushing them too fast, too soon. Also, fourth grade writing, oh gosh. I got my master's degree from New York. My test for the certificate was 2 hours. Fourth grade test is 2 hours. Most of the things that they're learning, I learned in eighth grade, also in high school and college. So I think, to sum it up, we could just really slow down a little bit in elementary school. And I know I'm going over my time, but you should also maybe consider talking to students and looking at the students on the first 3 days of school, and teachers and administrators, and then going back in the spring and seeing the demeanor change of the students and how they no longer enjoy coming to school. The excitement has faded, and our teachers and administrators are worn out.
Good evening. My name is Jerry Schumacher. I'm from Marietta, Okaloosa County. My main concern this evening is the lack of compliance inspections by FLDOE of the school districts. We have some excellent legislation starting in 2014 of Senate Bill 864, and another one following a couple of years later of CS 989. Both held amazing opportunities and transparencies for parents, and as well as shore up language, and especially in the area of objectionable material. We would not have to be in this position had we had the DOE compliance inspections at the district level. I can tell you from experience, it has been many times months 6 months, 9 months, a year after a piece of legislation would get signed into existence, effective date, until the school policies had been changed. And oftentimes, they fell far short of the statutes in their language. In objectionable material, the statutes are clear. There are many more than 40 objectionable pieces of material that are being looked at. And at the top of the list is, it's perfectly normal. And I believe you would blush if you read the book, and it's not perfectly normal. So what I would recommend then is that the DOE aggressively pursue their compliance inspections shortly after legislation, come up with self-inspection checklist, in which I will provide a copy of. Thank you.
And our next speaker will be Jared E.
Good evening, my name is Jared E. I am representing I'm a member of the Fort Troy State Council. A primary criticism of Common Core is not necessarily in its implementation or its specifications or demands of every school in the state of Florida, while those certainly apply statewide, especially here. Yet another broader issue that should be addressed with making such broad decisions for our state is the common resentment much of the public holds for such strenuous and streamlined standards, which force the classroom, whether it be in a small public school in suburban Orlando, a large institution in the center of Miami, or a rural school in an agricultural community within the Panhandle, in the same direction. Common Core is not only criticized for its vast generalizations in the wrong places, and its misplaced emphasis on frankly the wrong subjects, but also for its continuation of a trend of our state government dictating exactly how each student should learn, exactly what they should learn, and how they should learn it, regardless of their circumstances, the professional preference of the public school teacher, school, or otherwise issues which simply should not be so harshly interfered with by a state.
Thank you for everybody that came and spoke to us this evening. I hope that everybody that wanted to speak, I always pick on Dr. Burns, so if you're shy and bashful like him, you just want to fill out a card and leave that, we'll be happy to collect that as well. But I won't speak to all of the comments, but I'll just go through a couple of the comments that were made, if that's okay. We heard from several folks about some of the challenges with Common Core, which is why we're going through this review process to make sure that we update our standards to be the best. I know the first presenter mentioned some research that was cited around the dumbing down of students, so if they have not left, I'd be interested in seeing that, or if you have a copy of that, and I would love for your math example folks to connect with our math. As I stated earlier, a lot of times when we talk about standards, some of the examples we hear about are aligned with the textbooks and the curriculum, which is part of the challenge, and we want to make sure they're aligned. And if we don't have good textbooks, it's hard to have good lessons, so that needs to be part of the dialogue and the conversation. We heard some comments about Florida's performance on NAEP exams, which is one of the things that we want to look at. We value how well our students not only do in Florida's accountability system, but on our national report cards as well, so that's something that's a value of us. We heard, especially from the gal from FAMS, around the geometry standards and some of the verbs and the concerns around rigor. So if you're still here, we'd love to get you connected with our math folks to have a deeper conversation around that. And thank you for serving on the work group and the committee. I know you've been asked to give up a lot of free time, and it is a value. And one of the comments that I heard that was made is about a lot of the public feedback says that no change. So my response to that is we're collecting evidence, and we want to hear what people have to say. And if no change is one of the things they say, that's one of the comments they say. We're going to put out different drafts, we're going to put out different versions, so that we can collect evidence, and then at the end of this process, those work groups can help make informed decisions. But all of that data, all of that research that's been put in and submitted to us is taken into consideration. Heard some comments about slowing down in elementary, so the developmentally appropriateness is something that is feedback that we've heard, and we would love to have a deeper conversation with you, with our work groups, to make sure that those kindergarten readiness expectations trickle down into our learning environments before we get to kindergarten, but it's at an appropriate level, and then matriculated in first and second grade. We know taking the time to build those foundational skills, especially in literacy, with phonics, phonemic awareness, leads to fluency. We got to build vocabulary if we're going to build into comprehension. So making sure we build that foundation right really sets that student up for success in life. So thank you for those sentiments. Heard some other comments about making sure we're listening to the public feedback. And a couple of things that I just mentioned, there was a question about, is the textbook going to drive the standards? We have this notion and this belief that standards drive the curriculum, so we need to get our standards right. And as soon as we adopt new standards, we will be implementing a timeline to do an instructional bid to make sure that our primary instructional tools will be aligned to the standards. That will start with English Language Arts, and then the following year, mathematics. So that's part of this continuation process. So we want to make sure we get that right. And there's questions about training and resources. We agree completely with that sentiment. In fact, we've asked the legislature through our state board legislative budget request for some dollars to do that. So when the standards are adopted, we can immediately start doing some train-the-trainer models and updating the CPOM resources, and then doing the instructional materials bid, so that the teachers have the tools necessarily to design high quality instruction and lessons. Comments about questionable materials, 864 and 989. We can have some further discussions about that. A lot of those decisions are determined locally through local school boards and local decision making, but I'll be here. I would love to have a deeper copy and for a deeper conversation, and I believe the commenter said they have a copy for something for us to look at, maybe the most questionable material in the book, so that would be helpful for us to hear what those concerns are. And some other comments about Common Core focusing too much on the wrong thing. So this was very productive for us. I'm just curious, how many educators are with us tonight, teachers, administrators, district folks? Thank you guys. This is, wow, it's almost everybody. Wow, that's a great turnout. So thank you for being here. I know you know how important it is to get this right. We want to get this right. We know this is a fast timeline, but it's a goal and a challenge that we're up to. We're going to meet and exceed expectations. And we'll be here. Dr. Burns and I will be here for a little while. And some of our instructional team will be here. So please, please, please don't leave without giving us some further deeper dive and conversation. And thank you once again, Superintendent Hughes Board, for fantastic accommodations. This has been overwhelmingly a positive experience. Your team is so great to work with. And to the other superintendents from the neighboring districts, thanks for spending time with us this evening. We appreciate all the hard work that's going on in the Panhandle and everything you do to change the lives of our students. Have a wonderful evening.